Hello, good morning everyone. We are back. I'm Dr. A. Ramakrishnan, the Director and Chief Mentor of Yerki Academy of Higher Education Training and Yerki IAS Academy. Back suggestions which I got from my students, my colleague, and some of them were telling. Last time the video was little long, it was quite lengthy because they felt it's very long. But henceforth, I thought I will edit in such a fashion that will be roughly around 15-20 minutes of time. That will help the students like you to comprehend the whatever thought process or what deliberations which are happening. Today we are going to look at the third part of the series, the Electricity Amendment Bill Part 3. And henceforth I thought I will also introduce on a daily basis the deliberation and discussion on the editorial content of the Hindu. So that will help the students' community as well as the academic community as a whole, that always I try to introduce a great literature, a great literary protagonist, in order to look at humanity as a whole, where we can draw a lot of inspiration in these testing times. Today we are going to look at Goethe's Faust, a part one, which was written in 1808. Goethe was a great literary figure, a statesman, German, who lived from 1749 to 1832. Here we will look at the Faust, the protagonist. In the next session, maybe I'll try to explain about the character of Faust and Mephisto, which is called Mephistopheles. For the students' community, let me start reading this passage of the play. I've studied now, to my regret, philosophy, law, medicine, and what is worst, theology from end to end with diligence. Yet here I am, a wretched fool, and still no wiser than before. Mephistopheles lands. What's all the noise, sir? How can I be of service? Fast. What's your name? Mephistopheles. That seems a pretty question. That seems a petty question. But still I ask, who are you? Mephistopheles tells, I have the spirit of eternal negation, and rightly so, since all the gains existence is only fit to be destroyed. That's why it would be best if nothing ever got created. Accordingly, my essence is, what do you call sin? Destruction. Or to speak plainly, evil. Let's look at what Faust does, a great man, knowledge, what is going to be relation with Mephistopheles? What does an author, Goethe, talks about? The relationship, maybe in the next session. Just I want to make it very excited about this kind of new classic literature, which normally we don't read. But only through great literature, we can really move upon. We'll go ahead. As we're going to discuss about the Electricity Amendment Bill, which is table 2022 August, this is a timeline. The initial Electricity Act 2003 came in. Then 2007 there is an amendment. Then right from 2014 till 2022, there are a number of amendment bills either amendment bills were tabled or which has gone into the committee or it is in the stage of draft. Recently, if you look at, let me try to annotate. If you look at 2022, the bill has been introduced and it's gone to the Select Committee for analysis, for review. Now, before getting to the Act itself, if you've gone through the previous lectures, you would have seen the major opposition parties were talking about electricity, which is in Schedule 7, List 3 being a concurrent list, and it is Entry 38. So whenever we are talking about concurrency, it is concurrence between the union and the state. So the opposition parties were talking about it's violating the basic tenets of the Constitution, because when it's concurrency, when it falls in the concurrent list, the both the central and state has to act together. The deliberation has to happen between them before even legislation takes place. Now let us look at, in this session I thought I'll introduce you, or we'll discuss on some of the judgments on Supreme Court regarding this repugnancy. So here it talks about, before even any repugnancy can arise, the following condition must be satisfied. Why I'm introducing the concept of repugnancy? For a simple reason. When we are talking about Schedule 7, that will, when we're talking about List 1, List 2, List 3. List 1 is a prerogative of the union, List 2 absolute the state, and List 3 comes only when the both get together, both the center and the state. Here one of the judgment of Supreme Court Constitution by judgment in name Karnali versus Union of India in 1979, it talks about when repugnance can arise. Here it talks about the following condition is satisfied in order to have a repugnancy. Number one, there should be clear, let me annotate. There should be clear and direct inconsistency between the Central Act and the State Act. And that, number two, yet such an inconsistency is absolutely irreconcilable. Then it talks about, third, that the inconsistency between the provisions of the two acts is such of nature as to bring the two acts into direct collision with each other. Where it is impossible to obey the one without disobeying the other. That's what it talks about. Where in judgment, courts, in Colin Corbett's Australian Federal Constitution Law, it talks about, so when the nature of inconsistency between the two enactments observed as follows. It talks about an obvious inconsistency arises when the two enactments produce two different legal results when applied to the same fact. This is the basic gist of it. When two enactments are enforced, it produces two different legal results when applied to the same facts. So it means that repugnancy is very obvious. You cannot obey the both, but there's a direct collision with each other. So it talks about it's impossible to obey the one without disobeying the other. This is what it throws clarity on repugnancy. It throws a lot of light. So the legislator is the protagonist. So legislator is a bulwark of a democratic polity. So Article 254 kicks in when there is repugnancy in any provision of the law made by the legislature of the state to any provision of the law made by the parliament, which the parliament is competent to act. That's what it talks about. The most peculiar feature of Article 254, Clause 2 is the recognition of existence of repugnance between the law made by the parliament and state law, and rendering that repugnance inconstitutional upon procurement of presidential assent. So the judgment is throwing a lot of light on the role of legislator and discuss about Article 254 and Article 254 Clause 2, how the repugnancy between the law made by the parliament and state law upon procurement of presidential assent. Once you get an assent, it talks about the repugnancy doesn't arise. So this is the track, from will to act, the track. It was introduced, let me introduce, in Lok Sabha, December 23, 2005. It was referred to Standing Committee, same December 23rd, and Standing Committee gave the report in May 22nd, 2006, and it was passed in Lok Sabha in 2007, May 7th, and Rajya Sabha May 16th, and it has become the Electricity Amendment Act 2007 on 28 May 2007. Let us look at this Amendment Act. Let us look at, as I always tell you, both the students' community as well as any public policy, the fraternity which is interested in public policy has to look at what is the kind of objects and reasons for any amendment, any bill. Here, the Electricity Amendment Bill 2005, let us look at what was the objects and reasons. Now, if you look back, from 2004, UPA government came into being. So here, they discuss about one of the core objects for this Amendment Act, Amendment Bill, amending the bill. Initially, bill comes in, then acts, when it's passed in both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. The objective of the bill is, they have done a common minimum program. It's called National Common Minimum Program. When the UPA came into being, it was to give a proposal to amend the act in the various sections. One of the, let me annotate. One of the sections is Section 6. The Section 6 talks about, here it talks about, as per the Parent Act, that provides that appropriate government shall endeavor to supply electricity to all areas, including villages and hamlets. There has been a concern that the onus of rural electrification has been put only on the state governments. The simple reason, state government directly who are interacting with the public at large. So Section 6, they want to amend it. Yes, I mean, Section 6 was to provide that the concerned state governments and the central government shall jointly endeavor to provide access to electricity. Because the Parent Act was not directly spelling out that the responsibility of providing electricity should be the concern of both the state government and central government. So rural electricity infrastructure and electrification of households, Section 6 talks about. Then they want to amend the various sections like 38, 39, 40, 42, 61, 178 and 181 of the Act. Here it talks about reduction and elimination of cross-subsidies. The Parent Act in all these sections talks about there should be a reduction, the elimination of the cross-subsidies, which we already discussed about what is subsidy and what is a cross-subsidy. Subsidy is something like subsidized. Subsidizing from the cost. Gross subsidy, in order to subsidize certain population, subsidizing certain consumer segment who are underprivileged, we overcharge some segment of the population wherein the excess monetary benefit you get subsidized. So cross subsidy is talking about something where you subsidize set of population by getting or by overcharging or beyond the cost a certain segment who can afford. So here these above section talks about there should be a steady reduction and the elimination of cross subsidies. Here they show the concern that the common minimum program of UPA government were insisting there had been a concern that though the cross subsidies will be reduced, but the elimination of such subsidies may not be feasible for the present. So they want to amend the particular section, do away with the elimination of cross subsidies, so they want to have a reduction of will continue. We not, not to eliminate, maybe reduction of cross subsidies can be done. What was the initial from the Principal Act and what is the Amendment Act? For example, if you look at, let me annotate. If you look at here, the original Parent Act, it talks about the appropriate government shall endeavor to supply electricity to all areas, including villages and hamlets. Whereas it is amended in the following manner. Section 6 will be read henceforth that the concerned state governments and civil government shall jointly endeavor to provide access to electricity to all areas, including villages and hamlets, through rural electricity infrastructure and the electrification of households. Here it specifically talks about the concern for rural electrification lies with both the state government and central government. They jointly put together, they jointly work together in the world. Whereas here, the initial Parent Act, the appropriate government, it's not very specifically talking about who has to execute. But as we discussed, normally it's public at large, normally only the state government has direct relation. So the onus lies with the state. That was a basic apprehension raised by all the various state governments. So Electricity Amendment Act 2007 specifically spells out and it amends the Section 6. That's one of the major amendment. Second amendment, if you look at, as we talked about, from the Principal Act 2003, Section 38, 39, 40, 42, 61, 178, 181 shall be progressively reduced and eliminated in the manner specified by. So it will be progressively reduced and eliminated. Instead of the Amendment Act talks about the word eliminated shall be omitted. This elimination is removed. So the major amendment, the objective, what was the reason for the objective? The objects, initial when it was introduced the bill, for two reasons. One is the rural electrification has to be joint endeavor by both state and center. That's number one. Number two, instead of progressively reducing the elimination, they want the words elimination should be omitted. The progress is reduced. So these are the two major amendments of 2007. Hope you can appreciate. Now in the coming session, we're going to talk about what is the Electricity Amendment Bill 2014. You know that right from 2014, the new government and the leadership of the Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, came into being. Then they started introducing the Amendment Bill 2014, and we are seeing right now it's another bill which is tabled in August 2022. In the coming session, we are going to look at what is this Amendment Bill, what is the object, what is the objective, and what is the purpose of the film. I request you to mail me to aarkacademy2032@gmail.com, or you can Twitter at aarkacademy. You can always tweet me, because the learning is a dual process. I learn from you, from both students' community, as well as the academic community. With these kind of suggestions, it will help me in improving upon. Till we meet in the next session, I wish you all the best. We'll meet. Thank you then.